start streaming. I haven't done a stream for a while, so I'm not 100% sure that this setup still works. Well, we'll find out pretty quickly. All right, here we go. Let's see if we have audio. I think it should be okay. We'll find out. Let me click back over here and see what is up.
This is so cool. I see you looking up the wall when you do the videos.
Yeah. Now you know why. Yeah, figuring this out. Just trying to figure out whether or not it is...
I see you looking up the...
If I had somehow made it private or not. Let's see. How do I figure that out? Where did I put it? When I went to Albany, Lewis like changes stuff sometimes on my channel. So I can't figure out where we posted it. It does, but it's... Well, I guess there's 15 people watching, so that's fine. All right, we're going to guess that this is working. So we'll do a stream. We will see if chat says good job in Albany. All right, looks like this is live. All right, so what we're going to do today is I am here with Bonnie, who I just met 10 minutes ago.
Yeah.
And Bonnie, apparently. Bonnie is, are you 44?
49.
You're 49?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm 44. But you have a 13-year-old son. I have a 13-year-old son. And you went to college. What was your major in college?
Which one?
Undergrad.
I mean, which major? So it started violin performance. English.
Violin? Like...
Well, I went to conservatory in New York City. Then
okay.
I transferred to Butler University, did music, and then English, and then graduated in psychology.
Okay.
And then stayed and worked for them for a year so I could take classes in biology.
Okay.
And then I have a PhD in biomolecular chemistry from Wisconsin.
Okay.
University of Wisconsin.
Is that the Badgers?
Badgers.
Yes, yes. I thought about going there.
Butler is the Bulldogs.
Okay, cool.
Butler has been in the basketball scene.
Yes. Well, I used to teach over at UMBC, which is the Chesapeake Bay Retrievers. They, like, surprised everybody by not losing for a second there. So Bonnie lives up the street. And so I went to school and got a PhD in, what was it, human genetics, molecular genetics, something like that. But that's pretty related.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I kind of say, like...
Yeah, tiny little stuff
biology,
inside cells.
Cell
exactly.
Biology, whatever. Yeah.
And then I left science, and my kids started breaking devices, so I started learning how to fix them. And you did the same, right up the street.
Yeah, except I broke my own devices.
Oh, you broke your devices.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, my son broke one, and I broke one.
Okay.
So, yeah,
right.
We split
close
split
enough.
Didn't work, yeah.
All right, pretty close. All right, so... Now, how long have you been doing repair?
God, I don't even know. I had to leave work about 5 years ago on disability.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of started doing repair about that time.
Okay.
Because I thought it would be kind of... I wanted to fix my own iPhone when
yeah.
I broke it.
Mm-hmm.
And that turned out to be a lot more...
Is
lot
that,
harder than
is
I
that
thought.
iPhone fixed right now?
No, it's
no.
one of the phones I brought.
Oh, is it here?
It's here.
Well, we should swap it out. I remember it took me 2 years to fix the original phone that started it all.
Wow.
2 years, and it was such a joy that when it finally came on.
Yeah.
You know? But you have to do that yourself, you know, so let's do some skill building. All right, so Bonnie's here. So she sent me an email the other day, and I said, come on over. And what we're going to do is we're going to see if we can do a little... you know, kind of get out of jail free on, is this a MacBook? No, it is not a MacBook. This is an iPad Air, and we are going to do a little bit of skills here. And a lot of this is going to be tiny little changes that have to do with heat. I can tell from your questions earlier, your problem is going to be A stunning realization of over what appropriate thermal mass can do for microsoldering. And then it's all going to be easy from there. So this is going to be equipment. All right, so let's take a look at this board. So this is an iPad Air, and it is, we've isolated the battery, and this is here for a home button FPC connector job. And there's a lot of alien blood on this. So let's start with kind of erasing the past. And normally I like to take the iPad Air board out to work on it. It's not terrible to get it out, you know, so that we don't put like, you know, hot air on the battery. And but for this one, we're gonna say that ship has sailed. What we'll do instead is we'll get like a shield. So this is a iPad mini LCD, like behind the LCD, piece of metal, and we'll stick that just kind of here to just sort of help direct heat away from that battery area. So we'll just shove that in there. Alrighty.
That's a great idea.
And then we'll just kind of work in that area. So what we're going to do first is just kind of erase. So we'll see what some hot air can do to just get back down to square one. Okay. See if I can tuck that in under there a little bit. So is this stuff the UV curable mask?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's covering some scratches and stuff I put on the board.
Mm-hmm. So this stuff is pretty, you know, what I like about it is that it's easy to put on and it's easy to go back.
So how hot is the air right now?
So this air, you know, this air is, I've never measured it with the thermocouple, so I don't really know. And you can see just sort of like, you know, kind of in practice that I know that this air is hot enough to move those components, which isn't the goal. So what I would do if I was gonna recommend an air temperature, which I, you know, try not to, it would be hair dryer kind of heat for just getting rid of that, like, you know, getting rid of this goo. And that we can kind
of
see what's up.
My beautiful wires.
I'm getting rid of the beautiful wires. We're gonna all of those hours and afternoons.
Oh my God!
Of pain.
There are the traces.
All right. So we're gonna. All right. So we're gonna do a little bit more in here. So you have a nice microscope. Right?
Well, I can't see this well, but I have a Leica microscope.
So how much does your microscope cost if you were going to buy it at the microscope store?
Oh, Lord, I don't know. It's
$10,000 grand?
At least? Although it's 20 years old and doesn't work perfectly.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was probably $10,000 in 20-year-old money, so it's probably
okay.
$20,000 to $30,000 today.
Yeah. I want to look through a $30,000 microscope.
Yes,
now, what was that microscope's original purpose?
It was to enable scientists to inject DNA into an unfertilized frog egg, so they could genetically manipulate it and try to see what changing the genes did to the function of the cell, or even the function of the frog that grew out of that egg.
Did you ever work on frogs?
No, actually, I never did. This was before I joined that lab. So.
Yeah. So what was your model organism? Yeast?
Yeah, my favorite organism is brewer's yeast. Because I used to brew beer. I haven't done it recently, but I like to brew beer. But it's also a perfect model organism. Because you can start with...
Now, is brewer's yeast different than baker's yeast? Or is it the same dude?
Well, some people argue with me about that.
Okay.
I think they're the same.
All right.
The same species can do both. put it that way. But it's not always that species that you actually use to do it.
No, I heard there was such a thing as, like, artisanal yeast that, like, one of these microbrewery guys, like, harvested yeast out of his beard or something to make, like, some kind of custom brew.
That is creepy.
Is that a thing? Like, is that...
I've never heard of harvesting out of a beard.
I think that sounds kind of gross to me. I don't think
it
I could...
Really
I wouldn't order that.
I
yeah,
thought you were
exactly.
going to say, like, a like an oaken cask or something.
Oh,
that,
yeah.
That would be cool, right?
Yeah, some dude's half-degraded cornflake. Yeah.
Disgusting.
I hear you. All right, while we're working on here, let's pop out the sim dude. All right, we'll move that over there. We'll just kind of captain tape that out of the way. All righty, let's check in and see what's up with...
So that's isopropanol that you're working
yes.
with.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And while it's wet, it's a lot easier to see the traits.
It is. Yes, that's a good strategy there. All right. Wow, that's a lot of money. Yes, it is. Was it a Leica microscope? Yes.
It was in fact.
Still
it
is.
In fact,
still is.
Yes.
Yes. It's the same species used and cultured for the past century. All right. When I was in undergrad, we did Drosophila stuff. So, whole lot of... I spent an entire summer dissecting I had to pull the imaginal discs out of the embryo, which is harder.
Oh, my Lord.
You know, which is really hard,
small,
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's super tiny.
So you were good with microscopes.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I think that you know, like how many times have you had to, you know, pipette 4.3 microliters?
Well, I do that a lot.
Yeah, but I think
that skill,
loading a gel, it requires precision. I mean, if you look at a student try to do it, it's difficult.
Yeah.
You know, they're going to tear up the bottom of the well, you know,
yeah.
But... So I think that's a skill. All right, here's the deal with this. We're still not done with our cleaning phase because there's kind of, you know, this stuff. So when we, you know, we want to make all that behave, and the best way to do that to kind of like clean it all up is to use heat. So
was me trying to use silver conductive epoxy.
Oh,
that was
the,
one
the
of
paint.
My attempts.
Yes.
So there were several attempts at fixing this. I have
okay,
to say
gotcha.
That when I got it, it was beautiful. And I thought it would be an easy repair, and then I started to try and it got uglier and uglier.
Yeah. All right. Well, we'll turn back time. Okay.
Great.
All right, let's see. Aaron E knows something about some C. elegans. I never worked with that.
Ah, yeah. Well, that's
did
a
you?
Worm.
Yeah.
No, but I certainly know people that work with C. elegans. And I think C. elegans is pretty cool because it's got multiple cells, so you can watch, and they know what every cell of the embryo is going to develop into.
Yeah, that
so
is pretty cool.
So it's amazing for development and stuff like that. And Cerevisiae brewer's yeast is just a single cell, so it's not so good for development.
Yeah.
But it's really good for cell biology and genetics.
What I liked about the Drosophila people is that they were cool. Their whole culture is cool. Like, yeast people name genes YFG or whatever. But the Drosophila
Your
people... Yeah. Drosophila people name genes, you know, Sonic Hedgehog.
Yeah.
You know,
cool
stuff like
ridiculous.
That.
Ridiculous. Yeah.
Ridiculous.
Well,
ridiculously
so the
cool.
The elegans people have some ridiculous names, too.
Yeah.
I think. Correct me if I'm wrong.
What gene? What was the last gene that you worked on?
Oh God, I don't know.
My last gene I worked on, which I haven't thought of or said its name in at least a decade, was SMAD4.
Ah.
And SMAD4 is part of a TGF-beta signaling pathway, and it is one of the pancreatic cancer, you know, specific mutations.
Yeah.
They all get a SMAD4 mutation.
Huh.
Yeah. Which used to have the lame name of DPC4, deleted in pancreatic carcinoma number 4.
Well, at least it's a descriptive name.
Yeah, that's true. So SMAD4 was you know, it was the Drosophila homolog is MAD-H4, and MAD stands for Mothers Against Decapeniplegic. Decapeniplegic is a different Drosophila gene name. Yeah, so guess what decapeniplegic does? So great. Don't you just love the Drosophila people?
It makes something 15-legged.
Decapeniplegic, 15 things wrong with it, the embryo. Oh. Isn't that so awesome? So,
see, I was going to complain because the other names didn't actually mean anything relevant to their function, but that one actually does.
Yeah, so, sure does. Yeah. You know, so decapeniplegic, 15 things wrong with the embryo. And then mothers against decapeniplegic is the receptor. So DPP is the ligand. And MAD. Isn't it so clever? Love those Drosophila guys. MAD is the receptor. And, you know, then SMAD, so SMAD is from the SHH, like hedgehog was a Drosophila gene. Mm-hmm. Hedgehog makes the embryo look like a hedgehog. The little denticle patterns in a Drosophila embryo get disrupted, so it looks like a hedgehog instead of
okay.
orderly. So hedgehog. And then the human homolog they called Sonic Hedgehog, just to be
right.
funny. And so now SMAD is
against.
Sonic Mothers Against Decapeniplegic.
I saw that coming.
Yeah. You know, and you're like, yeast people, we're just going to call this Bub 1 or whatever.
Oh,
all right.
Yeah, they have rules like you can only have 3 letters. And
yes.
Like
yeah.
Yeah,
so oppressive. All right. Okay, so let's take a look now and see what we have going on here. All right, so we've got a missing dude here. And we can tell from...
That's my
We can tell from reading the board that, you know, you can see this, like, sort of dark black rim around this one.
Mm-hmm.
So that pad is isolated from things around it. But this pad is continuous with things around it. In fact, this is just paint, right? Like, we dug up some of it here. That's just paint. We dug up some of it there. That's just paint. So we can envision everywhere that's light brown as copper.
I thought it was copper.
It is. Oh, it is. Yes.
Okay.
So that means that this and this are going to both be ground. See how it's like continuous.
So that's,
so that's ground. This will also be, it'll also be the same stuff because it's all continuous.
Oh, so the black thing around the other pad isn't a trace.
No, it's the absence of anything. Right.
This
it's like a fence.
This is why I get into trouble trying to find traces, because
yes.
I look for them where the lines are.
Right. So then let's look and kind of apply. So then here, this is, so there's a missing, there's a piece of a pad here. So this is a piece of pad that's left.
Yeah.
And this is the space that it used to occupy.
Yeah.
And then this, brown, is a trace that's isolated from ground by the black fences. So this big fat thing here
God,
is the trace.
If I knew that big fat thing was the trace, this would have been so much easier.
Yeah, see, this one tell you. That's why I like about, you know, practical board repair school is all sorts of this. Oh, so this is easy.
Oh my
gosh. All right, so now we know.
I was trying to scrape those black things and I kept getting ground and I was like, why can't I get the trace?
Yeah. All right, so then we can kind of read the board here again and just be like, all right, well, what about this guy? And if we really look at it, what we're looking to see is, like, is something torn? And the answer is no. So this guy is just hanging out. There's green stuff on here. But as we look for a torn piece of copper, there's none. So this guy, we can look it up and confirm on the schematic or on ZXW tool, but we can tell that that's just a blank spot.
Yeah, it's on ZXW, it's a ground pin.
So then... this one is ground.
Yeah.
This one, I think, is NC, not connected, doesn't go anywhere.
Because
this one is ground, and I can tell it's ground because
yeah.
I can see... You know, let's make this a little bit more clear. We'll get rid of some more of the goo.
I know the third from the end is ground. I thought the one on the end was ground also, but I could be wrong about that. That's
yeah, the one on the end is ground, because we can read the board. Let's get more alcohol so make it kind of crisp up a little bit. All right.
That's so beautiful.
So now we can tell that that top side, the very, very top pin is ground. This one.
Yeah.
he's ground because he's continuous with this giant piece, which is, you know, undoubtedly ground, right? All of this is ground.
I'm so for people that are watching this on YouTube, like I always have, the thing we're looking at on the wall is like this giant display of the microscope. It is really fabulous.
Yeah,
it's
up
amazing.
There is a giant projector
like the
image.
The board is this big. I mean, the connector is this big.
Yes.
Not the board, the connector, which is actually this big.
Yeah, in real time. All right, so the top pad then is most definitely ground, right?
Okay, cool.
And then the second one we can tell, you know, goes to this big fat trace here, and it's going to go to this missing guy.
Yeah.
And then continue on. And then this third one is ground, because we can see it's torn. See how that one is not torn? It's fully separated. It's got the black all the way around it.
So that's a not connected.
Yes, that's a not connected. But this one here is ground, because we can see it was ground, it was just torn right there. That's how it was connected to ground. All right, next guy not connected, because they're just total squares. There's nothing, it's not like there was a lily pad there that has a stem that's torn. There's nothing. Like, it's
so
doesn't connect
any of that.
So why do
they use 14 pins if they're only going to use 4, actually?
I don't know, but if I had to guess, I would say because the existing flax, or, you know, so there's some sort of a engineering decision that would be, there's no sense in trying to design a new connector when this one works, that, you know, the home button has to be this fat, or, you know, I don't know.
Okay.
But it's not uncommon.
So then, when I lift this connector from the board and all those not connected pads lift off with it,
yep.
It's because they're not connected. Right?
That's exactly right. There's nothing that holds them there. They're very, very easy to brush off. So they're going to be the first ones to go. So usually when you do pull a pad, you know, most of the, your most likely case is that pad's not important because it was never connected to anything. Because that's kind of how they pull off.
So
right.
All it's doing really is helping the connectors stay there.
Right.
If anything.
Yep. All right, so then we can kind of like look through all of these. And now this one is also ground, because we can see that it's torn from ground. That's where it was once connected to ground. All right, and now we get to this one. So this one, this guy is important, and we can just kind of read the board and say, where did he used to go? Let's make that a little bit more clear.
You're going to see a lot of scraped up stuff. See me trying to scrape up the black stuff there, because I thought that was what I was supposed to get to.
Okay.
And then there's just a little bit of the actual trace scraped, and I was trying to solder that little bit while avoiding all the other stuff.
Yep.
And that really didn't work.
All right. So,
this is
all like kind of the paint pen stuff, which is, you know, throw that away.
It's actually a two-component epoxy. It seems like it would be really handy, but when I put it on something this small, it just diffuses
exactly
into these little particles and gets everywhere. And
it's not all right. So, but we can read this picture now and see, like, this is a missing pad. So we don't want to dig here, because if we did, what would happen?
I'd ground it.
We'll find something, and it'll probably be ground, right? But it's not going to be the trace, because the trace is over here. So we can just read the board and say, this is, the black is the fence, and that this is the trace, and we can see how he goes all the way over here to this resistor, or this component. Looks like a filter. Okay.
Yeah.
And that's the deal with that. Then
so that thing that's immediately connected to the rectangle, that's not...
That's just
that's ground,
it's the
too.
Absence... Right here is the absence of... It's like a footprint that we're looking at, where there used to be a pad and a trace that have been torn here.
Okay.
So this is the, like, scissor mark right there.
Ah.
And then what's left behind is the footprint, the impression of the old pad and trace.
So the board part of it is the part that starts after the footprint.
Yes.
Part I want to scrape if I'm going to solder to something.
Let's make a motto. I'm going to change the title to this video. It's going to be called Scraping is Raping. So scraping. Scraping
is raping in the videos.
Scraping is raping. You know. All right, we don't have to change the title, but scraping is raping is one of the sayings, because, you know, in general, you know, you don't want to scrape, you know. And I know there's videos out there, like some of the, when I was learning, I'd watch some of Philippe's videos, and he would say scraping, and he would scrape to, like, get to the trace. But in general, if you don't see it, then it's not there. So this idea of having to dig for it is generally going to get you in trouble.
Hmm.
So let's...
I'm curious how you're going to connect to this.
So how are we going to do this? All right, so I'm going to run out of time here because I'm supposed to go over there. Sounds like a good title for automatic demonetization. from YouTube. That's pretty funny.
Oh.
All right, so was that then a filter cap? It was either a filter. Wow, I just had the brain short of the century. Expected to hear Lewis when I saw the thumbnail. Oh, it's Jessa. Oh, it's Jessa. Okay. All right, so let's go back to this. And let me see. She's running behind. Let me tell her.
Good.
Let's see. I am in the middle of a video. I will just check in with you when done. Maybe we can do tomorrow. Alright. We'll see. Alright, let's just finish this up. That's what I tell her a lot. I'm like the worst. In fact, and 6 months will go by, and then I'll just send her a text. I'm like, make me come sit in your chair. All right. So then let's talk about the next one. Next one down, it goes nowhere from what we've now learned.
Surrounded by black.
Surrounded by black. And then the last one, we can read the board, and the board says it is connected to this long, skinny highway. So it goes to the bottom of that resistor.
Does it go to the trace next to it, too? Or not? Or might that be something else?
It's supposed to have black, 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 black.
Okay.
And in general, you know, these are circuits, so they're wires. So they're only going to, you know, this pad will be one wire. So whatever that wire goes to, might go to a couple different destinations. But one pad isn't going to talk to multiple different pieces of wire.
Huh, okay.
All right, so we want to get rid of conductive stuff that's kind of around. So if this was not that, like, epoxy ink, that epoxy ink is making it hard to, you know, it's making, it's hard. Like, you don't want things to talk to each other. Like, this guy looks in appearance like a filter, and in fact it must be, because I don't see it connected to ground. So that means that it's essentially a wire, but it's kind of doing a job of filtering. So we don't want to, like, have an ability for metal to bridge across it, or, you know, go around. All right. So we also want it to be pretty flat, so that new connector can not have to sit on a speed bump. So we'll kind of make this go like
that.
That
probably would have helped it not come off.
Alrighty, and we'll have it be like that. Alright, so now this thing jumps out at me. This little nub.
Yeah.
Alright, so let's talk about what the heck is that, and where did he come from, what is he? So let's see. Is it... Okay. Alright, it looks like it was just a fleck of the epoxy ink.
I think
ink
it
stuff?
Might have been me scraping it around, because I thought the pads were active themselves.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if I dug under the covering of that rectangle, I would get to the trace,
mm-hmm.
which turns out not to be true.
It is true sometimes. You know, some of them are... Every pad has one of three things going on. One, it's not connected to anything, and that's a common case here. Two, it's connected to something from the side, like this one.
Uh-huh.
And three, is it is a lily pad on a stem, so it's connected to something from the bottom. But when that's the case, you'll be able to see what look what I thought we were looking at there, a dot, like a tiny coming up from below, horizontal elevator in the board, little tip of a shaft, an elevator shaft, that you'd be able to see there. All right, but I don't see any of that going on. So we would want to check in the schematic, but as far as we can tell right now, we have just ground here, this trace up there, ground here, a bunch of nothing, ground here, this trace on the number 3 spot, nothing on the number 2 spot, and then on the number 1 spot in the bottom, it goes to the other trace.
And not that I cheated ahead of time, but that's exactly what the schematic says.
All right. So then we'll skip looking it up on the schematic. Hooray. Okay. So what I'm doing is just kind of making sure that we aren't going to have something inappropriately talking to something else. And it looks like we'll say we're okay on that. I think that when I look at this sort of from far away, my biggest concern would be, is this trace that's torn electrically talking to ground, for example, through this bit of ink, like conductive ink. So let's kind of get that out of there. All right. So on these ones where there's some digging, you're not in trouble this time because most likely that what you've dug up is ground just by virtue of the fact that there's ground everywhere. But let's use the multimeter to check on that. So we're going to just ask, hey, we're going to guess that this is supposed to be ground. Is it ground? And it is not. How about you?
Where are you now?
Oops, I'm off the screen. All right, so what I'm doing is I'm saying, you know, hey, where's ground? This is ground. And if I touch like a screw bracket or the shield, that's ground. So I'm confident that that's ground. This will be ground. This is not ground because I can tell that it's a trace that goes somewhere, so it can't be ground. And then this is going to be ground here, the edge. And then just because I see a large piece of metal there, I'm going to guess that it's ground, but the multimeter says it's not. So that center part there is not ground. So what is it? I don't know. We could do something like this and say, all right, I've got a piece of metal in there, and I could just kind of like, you know, probe around until I get a beep. So I'm getting a beep here. From experience, I'm pretty sure that this section here is the 5 volt charger voltage coming in.
Okay.
So that means that if my new connector, which is supposed to be talking to ground here, actually talks to 5 volt USB, that's a problem.
Yeah.
So that's why scraping is raping. Yeah, I mean, like, because now that's, oh, gee, well, God forbid, it really can't touch that because it's supposed to be ground, and that's not ground. So we have to cover that up, and now we'd like to go back in time and have not intentionally revealed that, because if it touches ground, then we will, what would happen to the device overall if that touches ground?
Well, it's going to short out.
It's going to short out
the
charger voltage.
Right.
So it couldn't charge.
Right.
So it would turn on and test home button. Home button works. Send it back to the guy. And then you're going to get a phone call. Thanks so much. I put everything all back together because you're right. The home button works. But now it won't charge.
And I would have absolutely no
And you would have
idea.
No idea why. Exactly. Okay. And it would be very difficult to find that, you know, like
yeah, because I thought that was fine because it was a ground pad anyway, so scraping off copper would just be exposing ground.
Right.
So
and normally that is the case, but this particular board, the way that it's architect, you know, sort of its architecture, like if you look at, you know, here's charge port. Charge port goes and it solders to the very, like, right under there, right?
Yeah.
Like, okay. You know, so charger comes up there. And then it's going to find its way through the board to go to wherever charging happens. And so just kind of by chance, by chance on this particular board, you've got this, you know, pretty wide, you know, broad, look how big this section is. But see how it's isolated from ground itself. This whole neighborhood then is not ground because it's fully isolated by this fence all the way. So this is a large, giant piece of metal that's not ground. So, you know, what is it? Well, you know, probing around says, you know, if we looked up on the schematic, what does that guy talk to? He's going to be like a filter on, and I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure that this is the 5-volt USB charger in voltage. So this then, you know, we don't want to like mess with. All right. So now we have a good picture of what we need to, of what's going on with this. And then, you know, same thing down here on this fourth from the bottom pad. We're going to use the multimeter in continuity mode just to say, hey, what's up with you? And we're going to say over here, this is ground. And it's ground if we touch any kind of, you know, bracket on the device. And so this little nub is ground. Now let's test. Are you ground? And the answer is no, which is surprising because you'd think that if you find a big swath of metal like that, that it's going to be ground, but it's not. So then let's say, hey, are you the same by chance as, you know, other stuff around? You know, just kind of going like that, and I get a beep over here.
Okay.
So are you the same as this? Yes. So there's just this big piece of metal that happens to be in that second layer going under there. That is a different dude.
Okay, I think I'm convinced.
Okay, great. So, all right, then it's your job to come up with something other than the catchy scraping is raping that makes people not
work.
All right, come up with that. We'll go with that. Now let's see. Let's see just for fun, if we can see what that actually is. Let's see. iPad Air. Your face is hilarious. Oh. All right, let's see what it is. This dude, I think it's that. Yeah, so it's the component there that's beeping is L6157. And L6157 on the schematic.
Now, sometime you're going to have to show me how to do that because I haven't figured out how to do that.
ZXW? Okay. All right, so it is on a line called PPVBus USB.
Uh-huh.
And then EMI.
I think you're right on, yep.
And so that's a ferrite filter, acts like a fuse, and then, you know, PPVBus. VBus means charger voltage. All right, so that's
nailed it.
The deal with that.
Okay.
So, now we know that we have to protect, you know, we gotta...
Even if it had stayed in place, I would have screwed the guy.
Yes.
Sorry, John.
Don't worry, John. We got this. We'll get you all fixed up. Okay. So, what we're gonna have to do first is cover that, then.
Yeah.
All right. So, we're gonna cover that up. And we're going to use, wherever somebody stole my green epoxy, this stuff.
So after scraping off all that green epoxy, you're going to add to it.
Now I'm going to add back. I'm going to add some back, exactly. All right, what kind of device did you repair in the lobby at the right to repair? Well, Gay Gordon Byrne brought a toaster that... you know, one of the guys repaired. I helped a staffer figure out how to fix her own 6S that needed a screen replacement. I did like a 6S backlight job, just kind of
in the lobby.
In the lobby.
Oh, that is so cool.
That was really fun. I mean, it was really cool with the staffer, you know, where she it was just like a lot of people, like, oh, I can't do that. I'm not going to open my phone. And I was like, well, here, you're going to just, you'll do this, you do your phone it tonight, but for now, I want you to open up this phone. So we had, you know, two of them, so it was just kind of like, all right, here's the panel lobes, take those out. One thing I really loved was I met a woman named Jeannie who has started this school program for fifth graders to take apart their phones, their own cracked screens. You know, and so she gets the parts.
All these fifth graders commit crimes.
That's right. Yeah, she's turning fifth graders into criminals. It is a sad, sad state of affairs.
That is a sad state of affairs.
Yeah, but it's really great, you know, like how she is, you know, kind of giving them a skill and teaching them. And she's kind of had them, she said she used that lesson of me getting my parts confiscated as a lesson for the fifth graders. All right, so we're just going to put a little bit of this on just to be sure that our new connector can't accidentally touch anything that it's not supposed to.
You just squirted that onto a piece of paper and then you're putting it on with
tweezers. I put it on a post-it note and, oh, this is what, the last class, this was hilarious. They were like, what do you use to apply that stuff? And then I was like, well, I really kind of use like a tiny little paintbrush. So they were like what? And I was like, well, let's try this. Let's try a piece of gray hair. And it was totally, totally awesome. So they were like, thought it was hilarious. I gave one to the next guy, and then they were like, you should sell this on iPad Rehab Supply. I mean, look how perfect this is. Like, if you take a single piece of hair, you know, so here's like a single piece of hair.
And does gray hair work better? Because it's
look at how it's like a total paintbrush.
Oh my,
I mean,
God.
Isn't it great? Like, it's exactly the right size for, like, you know, let's just paint that little, you know, stripe cloth. You know,
there's something just wrong about that.
Yeah, exactly. it was like hilarious to be like, they were like, we're gonna come back here to take a refresher course next year, and you're gonna be bald from selling little hair paintbrushes.
Well, this will be perfect because my dog hair is floating all over my house.
Oh
now.
Yeah, dog hair
on the board, so I can just I can use it now.
Yes,
it's a tool.
It is a tool. Yeah, there you go. It's practical board repair.
Very practical.
Using a hair.
That's crazy.
So just paint that right up. There we go. And that's
the
so
upside
perfect.
To going gray, I guess.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
all right.
There you go.
All right. So now we're going to use the... That's not fair. How are bald guys like me supposed to do this? Rodrigo, you can buy one of the iPad Rehab beautiful gray hairs on iPad Rehab Supply. Yes, Bonnie will donate a hair. She has extra. All right, so now I'm hunting around for this UV curable thing. And
I'll just not watch this part.
Yeah. Well, it's funny, like UV, like, you know, I think is a big deal. All right, we're gonna UV cure it. Let's see what happens. I've never tried to UV with the camera on. Well, that's pretty cool because you can watch it up there and like see if you can actually watch it solidify, which is pretty cool. Did you ever get a sunburn in the lab from failure to comply with protection at the UV transluminator when developing a gel? I did. Just like...
I thought you were reading off
the... No.
No, I never sunburned myself in the
you
lab.
You didn't?
No.
Oh, what a...
No. Although I did break the rules with the transilluminator pretty often. I could say that because I don't work there anymore, but...
Yeah. What is the worst lab accident you ever had? Yeah, I like this. You can really, like...
Oh, this wasn't me. Does that count if it was a grad student in a student named Cindy accidentally spilled a liter bottle of 100% acetic acid onto the floor, out of the fume hood and onto the floor. And acetic acid is what vinegar is, except in vinegar it's what, 2%?
Super diluted.
Or something. So
yeah.
This was 100% acetic, and everything smelled like vinegar.
Yeah.
Like everything. And she was wiping as fast as she could, you know, and trying not to get the hazmat team to show up and all that. And
yeah.
So that was the worst.
That is pretty. That I can imagine how, like, cloying that would be, the smell of that. Well, for me, I did, back in the Kern lab, there was a day where I was, you know, doing, back when you had to do DNA sequencing using, we were doing a dinucleotide gel, back when you had to use P32 to, like, label your...
Okay, they don't use P32 anymore.
Well, I don't know. Do they? I mean,
I don't know.
Don't they? Isn't it all like colored? The colored capillary electrophoresis, like DNA sequencing, like colored, the capillary electrophoresis where the shit's colored and it goes through
okay,
the thing and it reads
me
the
feel
thing.
Really
and
old.
I'm sure it's fine. Yeah.
You know what we were doing? Come to think of it, I didn't do a lot of DNA sequencing in my more recent jobs, but.
Uh-huh.
We would just ship it off somewhere, and they did whatever it is they did, and we got.
Wave a magic
back.
Wand. All right.
So, and they were colored lines.
Yeah.
So
there
you
go.
Maybe
yeah,
they
that's
were
what
doing,
it is.
You know.
No, my impression is that the you know this is I mean this is I think pretty old, but.
But I did the actual gels too. I'm
yeah. Sure. So you did the gels. So you have to add your P32. So.
Which is radioactive phosphorus for those of you who aren't scientists.
Yeah. So you go and. And get it out of the fridge.
Mm.
There's a shield, and you're adding it,
mm-hmm.
and then you have to, and you're being super careful, and you got like the beep beep beep, you know,
you're
around you,
not wanting to irradiate yourself.
Yeah, you know. But I had in pipetting it, you know, you take the lid off, and you're super conscious of this fucking bad shit. Put it there, and you're pipetting. And then I put the lid on it, like a quarter turn, just to keep the lid there, not flying around or loose or to have that open. And then I take my tubes and do whatever. And now I have, you know, taken them and put them in a whatever. And now I've come back to clean up. And I have forgotten. I mean, I look at the thing and I have forgotten that I just barely put, I'm just resting the lid on it. So I lift up the P32 by the lid, and I bring it around the shield so that it's, I'm exposed, totally exposed, and that's when the tube of it drops away from the lid, and
oh
I just feel
God.
On my face.
You could feel.
I could feel it, like water. You know, like I felt it, and I just went. Oh shit! And the you know like the people
oh,
come
so
running
and
like
the
stay right there.
You just felt
no, not the radiation.
Okay.
I felt liquid. Like I'm
okay.
I have. I'm
oh
gonna.
God.
I just there goes 10 years of my life. There, hello cancer. You know, like might as well go smoke now because it's coming. You know, so it was awful. And then the worst part is then my boss comes and he's like you know super laid back and he's like, all right. So, you know, he piles up all of the, you know, like, diapers everywhere. Gets all that, like, you know, I mean, this is a big fucking mess, you know. So he's, like, I remember him holding the like, you know, little counter probe thing, and he's like, beep, beep. And I'm like, oh, shit. So I have to, like, stand there and, like, get naked in front of my fucking mentor. Because, you know.
Oh, my God.
It's awful. The worst
okay,
part of it all.
Totally outdone my leader acetic acid. I'm blown out of the water.
The worst part of it is that I was wearing red underwear that day, and so in the end, like
yeah,
I was just thinking
you
about
really
the
had to get naked in front
it's so bad.
Oh,
I know. And then put all of that stuff in. You know, everything was contaminated. My tennis shoes, everything. And then I'm wearing a lab coat with just pockets with red underwear and a lab coat for the rest of the day. And you know, it was. I was just
you
thinking about it the other
worked
day.
Worked for the rest of the day and nothing but a lab coat and red.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't mean to be a wimp, but I think I would have gone home. Maybe taken a shower and got.
Nah, it's already done.
Yeah,
all right, here we go.
Oh
okay.
Goodness.
So let's
let's
finish this up then.
Yes,
so we're gonna so that's all cured now. So that's nice and ready to go.
Okay.
And we're gonna just start by getting a new dude on there, and then we'll deal with the problem.
Okay.
Problem
so
areas.
Solder it on, but there's nothing to solder to.
Well, let's see. There's the anchor pads. Let's see what it looks like.
Okay.
All right. So the his strength comes from these dudes.
Yeah.
And then everything else is kind of minor.
But those are the hardest things to solder, I thought, without melting the plastic.
Well, they're ground, so they don't like to take heat.
Yeah.
All right. So what we're gonna do is put some.
But they're also like covered by the, pretty much covered by the connector. That's why.
Yeah.
That's what I found hard.
It is hard. Those can be a challenge. All right, so we're gonna just grab an iron. And the because ground is everywhere. Ground is an enormous thermal mass. It's a heat sucker. You know, it's gonna suck up heat. So we're gonna. Whoops.
So you just preloaded that with solder.
Yeah, so I'm just going to kind of make, what I say, make puffy pillows on these pads.
Just the two grounds?
Really, all of them. So they're all puffy pillows now.
Anything
so I touched that, and I touched that.
Okay.
Those things that it's going to sit on. All right, so I don't want it to be like, I don't want to have a Hershey Kiss or a Mountain Peak there so that this dude can sit. All right.
Good analogies.
Yeah. So we're going to look and see what we need to connect to. So that piece of metal needs to be, firmly anchored on both of these. So, how are we going to do that? We can think, well, my choice is I could try to use hot air. And since I've now tinned over them with leaded solder instead of the lead-free that was on there, it would take lower temperature. We could try that. But these flaps in general don't like hot air. But still, it's a good skill to see, can I get that pad to be liquid? If I can really press that down there and make a really good joint without bothering the connector itself. So we could try playing around with that. And then the other option would be, okay, what if I can't do that? Then I have to use an iron. Now, since it's ground, even though it's tiny, we're tempted to try to use a tiny tool, but tiny tools can't deliver the heat that big tools can.
Yeah.
So, we're gonna have to use a bigger tool.
Okay.
So really, the best tool would be the biggest tool we have. This guy.
Oh my lord!
Because that guy make things hot. Yeah, so he can make that spot hot. He can make it hot, whereas, other tools really can't. So we'll just kind of shove that in there.
By now, that plastic would be unrecognizably melted if I were doing that.
Well, don't touch the plastic.
Well,
all right, so
I
so
that.
Now
it's one thing to know it.
See, he's on there.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So that's anchored, which means I could operate that connector. He'll be able to stick on there with this one, this pad, and that pad, and he'll be down there. You could connect and disconnect. As long as it doesn't get too fluxy and sticky with flux, that would be fine. But let's try skill building. Let's try and see what can we get away with hot air. So I don't know the answer to that. So I'm just going to, experiment and see. I think I'll back off on my airflow, and I'm just making this up. Can I ride a bike here?
Look out for the part of the antenna wire where I had to cover it with epoxy. That part. Oh,
yeah.
We uncovered it already.
Yeah, he'll be all right.
Fix it.
Yeah. All right. So I know that the flap is doesn't like heat. So fair enough. And I'm going to just see, it may not be possible, but I'm going to see, can I just sort of ride a bike here, which means just sort of read a situation and respond to it in real time as I look at the connector and look at the surrounding area.
And
I'm staying.
Your tweezers are just touching metal, the metal
side.
Yeah,
I'm staying way over here.
Okay.
I'm trying to avoid, you know, putting hot air on the flap. Now, this one here, I can at least see that little tiny spike of it.
Yeah.
So when that's liquid, that will, like, kind of suck up. Oh, see? It doesn't like it.
No.
Well, let's try it anyway. There, he's liquid there. And he's liquid there. Yeah. So
you just pushed down on the pins with
that. I pressed down on it because I just had the feeling, and he's still quite high. We'll look at it on an angle. So this is, you know, a little crispy. But it's functional, and it's certainly anchored really, really well because I did it with hot air.
Okay.
You know, so that's, you know, just kind of another skill. There's no one right way. But let's take a look on all sides so that we can really see what's going on. So now when we look at that, you know, kind of anchor joint, it's okay. It could use some more solder, but it's definitely really in there.
Oh, I see what
you know. And then see this one? It's really in there.
Okay. Yeah.
And then if I look, it's not going anywhere. If I look in there, that's all fine. It's you know, it kind of looks like the guy got a little bit of a sunburn on his top lip here.
Yeah.
But that's not going to make it difficult to use that connector or anything like that. And that's just sort of a consequence of the hot air. I'm happy with the latch. The latch didn't become unusable.
Because you stayed way...
Because I was, you know, just kind of trying to stay over there and keep my eye on it. You know, so the latch is totally fine. You know,
yeah,
I can... It'll
awesome.
Work as a latch. But see how I was pressing down it because I could sense that it's kind of too high. So as I... You know, if we imagine that all those pads were there, I guess it's like it's okay now. You know, but some of these are sort of up a little bit. And when they're up, they're going to be hard to make a joint on. All right, so from here...
I thought you were trying to actually make those joints, and I think you did.
Well, yeah, but they're not robust, you know. So this is this is a pin sitting on top of a pad, and we want to see a ski slope from the top of the mountain down to the bottom. So we're going to...
Oh, okay.
So there's really no way that you can kind of use hot air to, like, get connectors started or to finish connectors, but in the end, they really need to have... they need to... have hand soldering. So we'll come through and we're going to do with the mini hot tweezers. This is where the mini hot tweezers really shine on connector work. We'll come in here and just kind of kiss it. There. So that made like a ski slope when we look at it on the side. And then this one as well, we'll just sort of kiss it. All right, and then we'll look on the edge.
That's one thing my $20,000 Leica doesn't do as well, is move around like yours.
Oh, yeah?
What
a piece of crap. All right, so...
It's a very fancy piece of crap.
Very fancy, very expensive piece of crap. All right.
Good optics.
Yeah, so now that's a joint. That's like what you... That looks like, you know, all the other joints in the iPad. That's not going to rip off.
Yeah.
All right, so now...
Unfortunately, it's not connected to anything electrically, but it's
yeah,
on
it is.
There.
It's connected from here. There's his trace, and he goes down to the bottom of that resistor. There's his pad trace, because if he wasn't, that pad would be long.
Oh, I thought he didn't actually have a pad. I forgot he actually
had
a pad.
Yep.
Oh, okay.
So next guy doesn't have a pad and doesn't go anywhere. Third guy needs a micro jumper.
Yeah, that's the total.
All right, so we're going
to
do...
And I made a macro jumper all the way to the component.
Yep, and there's nothing... There's nothing wrong with that. You know, that's totally valid strategy.
It kind of makes a mess, but...
So we will just grab some very, very thin...
Now that hot air wouldn't have interfered with your you used epoxy to block off those places where I'd scraped.
Mm-hmm.
Hot air wouldn't have interfered with that at all.
That, no.
I'm not worried about that.
No, that particular epoxy is kind of meant for this job.
Okay.
All right, so let's do the same thing you did, and we'll go back to the, you know, back to the component at the end of the line here, and solder it to that, and then we'll just let it follow the natural lay of the land.
It took me slightly longer than that. Only slightly,
just a little bit. All right, so then we'll come along in here and we'll stick this on the, you know, ideally on the top of that. So let's see. He goes to the number three. Now this is has insulation on it, so I'm going to kind of tin that over here.
Right, so that's not copper braid?
That one is not copper braid because it's long. So, mm-hmm. You know, it's just a... I'm going to move it down a little bit.
It's just a really
high-gauge wire. Yes. 44-gauge insulated wire. Yep.
I didn't know you could buy 44-gauge wire.
You can.
Wow.
You can. 44-gauge wire. Available at iPad Rehab Supply. Yes.
Okay.
So, you know, like, super thin. Which is great, because these are going to be like, you know, some kind of little data, one and zero for the home button. And that is it. All right, so that, then I'm going to take care of the tail that's too long. Now, there's no reason why, you know, I happen to solder here to the end of the connector, just because that, or to the component there at the end, because it's easy and, you know, that's fine. But I certainly could have soldered it anywhere along, you know, and connected it to that trace anywhere along there.
Now, is there anywhere where I scraped the board and it's going to short?
No. I mean, we can test with a multimeter,
okay.
but right
cool.
Now I don't think so.
Great.
All right, so that's on there. So now it doesn't have any ground. So it's connected on 1, 3, and this guy here at the end. But there are, you know, this one is supposed to be ground, and that one is supposed to be ground.
Yeah.
So we need to, you know, give it a ground. So we'll do that. Now, what we just learned is that in an unusual turn, I'm not sure, maybe this is ground, but I'm not 100% sure that it is, because I know that's not ground. So we need to check before we just kind of assume that that's ground. It looks like ground.
Oh, I scratched right through a trace when I did. Look at that.
So we're going to go back to continuity mode. And we're going to stick here and say that's definitely ground. And then just kind of, you know, probe. Let's see. If we were to try to, you know, stick a wire right here, is this ground?
Oh, you're trying with the wire, you're trying to get through the paint.
Yeah, okay, so that is ground. All right,
okay.
So that means that we can make this go here to ground and that this can, you know, go here to ground. That this piece right here, all of this, is in fact ground.
Okay.
So we can...
What I'm noticing now that I can see better is that that copper scratch I made actually
cuts
across
into
the trace.
It does, yes. Mm-hmm. So this,
so
this trace
not,
here,
I could've
you could have chopped him off, but
that.
You didn't. So, or at least we don't think you did. I mean, it doesn't look like it's broken to me, but
no, it's not a wire.
Right.
It's a scratch.
Yeah, that's a scratch, but
yeah.
I don't think you cut the trace. So let's just check.
Oh.
Yeah. So you have continuity. That's you have continuity from there. Huh?
I was just thinking I could have jumped to it.
Oh, to that piece?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
But.
Yep. All right, so then let's do some...
But you didn't have to jump that one because there was a little bit of pad there.
Right,
so
exactly.
The mini
yep.
pad.
Yep.
Yeah. This is cool, 44-gauge wire.
Yes.
Is this magnet wire?
It is.
Wow.
All right, so let's make a couple of
Okay, bald guy, whoever you were, this works. Instead of hair, it's about the same thing.
About
probably
the
not
same
as
hair,
much
but.
Like a brush, but
well, Mark,
about the same
Mark
thickness.
One time was doing trace repair, and he was, you know, wondering about, you know, why is this one wire not, I can't tin this wire, why not? And then it just kind of kept disintegrating. And then he realized that he couldn't tin it because it was one of his own gray hairs that just had fallen down, and he was like, oh shit, time for bed.
Yeah, if you start tinning your hair, it's time to quit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so we're gonna...
That's a good rule.
Yeah. So, you know, we could probably get away with not caring about, you know, every ground pad that there is on any connector. But
really we need one, right?
We don't have any, so we're gonna worry about them on this one.
Does it matter which pin goes to ground? I mean,
well, I'm gonna guess yes, because I'm gonna guess that the way the connector is designed, you know, that it may or may not have continuity within the connector, the flex, you know, to get one ground to everywhere.
Right.
So I don't know.
So you have to you have to ground to at least one pin that was designed to go to ground.
Yeah, I think that would be the safest thing to do.
But you don't have to connect to every pin that was designed to go to ground, right?
Probably not. As long as you know that you have sort of an internal connection to ground. So in kind of just the general practical rule that I use is, I'm not going to worry about like a single ground. But I am going to worry about, you know, if I'm missing two or three, you know, then I'll start to wonder if they have a functional property. So ground is an incredible heat sink, and it can be, you know, difficult to tin with the too small of a tip. You know, it'll feel like mud. So the bigger the tip, your big dog is your ground dude.
Okay.
You really can't work on ground with a little tiny tip. As tempting as it may be.
You're just bending that back and forth and it breaks.
Yeah.
Cool.
So we're going to wiggle that off. And it also tells you that it's like a robust joint because you're able to do that to it.
Yeah.
All right. So that seems okay. I'm going to clean that out, and then we're going to look at the schematic and then see if that is the only connections that we need to make, which reading the board says it is, but we don't know for sure.
Now, what about the components that aren't there anymore?
So those we have to, you know, kind of deal with and sort of understand what do they do and figure out what the consequence of not having them is. So what we're missing over here is almost certainly I'm not sure now because that's no longer, that's the, probably
that
the
might
USB
be the
5
thing
volt.
I have on a little post-it note that says original diode.
Oh, look at that. I just threw up my jumper with that. Let's fix that back up.
Oops. Robust, but not.
Yeah, exactly.
That
not
robust.
Not that robust. I'm trying out today a new flux that we're gonna.
Yeah, it looks thicker than the stuff
how
I
we
use.
Like it.
I sort of thought flux was flux, but yours looks different.
Yeah, flux at some level is flux. Let's do this. We'll do it again. We actually just got sent the wrong stuff, so rather than toss it, I was gonna see whether or not we can like it better. I don't know. So far, no, but let me go back to my other typical flux. Yeah, he's gonna be too short now.
Oh, was this the macro jumper?
Mm-hmm.
So well, you could just jump to the other spot, couldn't you?
Yeah, we're gonna take off that piece of wire, stick this, make it tinned. It also helps to have really good tweezers, which these ones are not.
Now, what are you soldering it to now?
This is the trace. Oops, that's a little bit hard to see.
Oh, I see.
So he's too short to go all the way back over to what I think is a filter over there, so we're just going to instead tin the trace.
Oh, so you're just tinning it right through the paint.
Yeah, I'm just going to...
I didn't know you could do that.
Yeah.
I thought you had to scrape it.
Nope.
No scraping.
Nope, because
scraping is bad.
Bad.
I'm going to think of a better way to say that.
Scraping
is bad.
All right, so all that's back on there. All right, and then we, lost our ground one as well, so let me instead swap that out for a piece of braid, because braid is a little bit thicker. So this is a single-ply piece of braid right here. So two tweezer tips together, because ground is tough. So we can get it anchored into ground.
No, I can't see it again. Oh, there it is.
Make it come over here. All right, fair enough. And I don't want that ground tail to touch anything.
No. It doesn't break as easy as the other stuff.
Wiggle that off.
Yeah,
all right. And then let's try to pay attention and not vigorously wipe it this so that it comes off. So when you do these, getting the flux off, if the board was out, then we would drop it in ultrasonic, because the flux will, it's still around in here, and it will turn gummy. And it will make the connector itself difficult to use. So you might have one that, it works great. But then when you let it sit for, a day, it will be really gummy in here.
I wonder if that's why John had trouble getting the cable in.
Yeah, that
could be. Because in the 3 days it got to California.
Mm-hmm.
Or it could be any of a number of other things. But it's good he couldn't, because then he couldn't have charged.
Yeah.
And I would have been stuck, and yeah.
Yeah. All right. So now let's look on the side and make sure that we don't have any kind of anything bridged by accident. We've got ground, trace, other ground, other trace, and normal connection. All right, seems okay. So let's look up on the schematic and just make sure that we are not missing anything. So this is the XW tool. So we're going to just click. All right, ground. So the one on the end, we have these two. And then we have, let's do show all not connected. All right, so we have this one and this one. All right, and it's telling us that this fourth one is ground. All right, so traces are number 1 and 3.
Mm-hmm.
1 and 3, and then
13.
So let's just check to make sure we've got 1 and 3 and 13. So let's check. All right, so when we look, we have 1 is going there, and we could, you know, just be really sure, since we don't want to have any kind of problem with this one. We'll just use the multimeter to be sure. So from up in the top of the connector, through the connector in its joint, 1, and then 3, and then ground, and then 13, which should go to this right there, and it does.
Awesome.
And we'll make sure that none of those go to ground, and they don't. All right. So that tells us that we are pretty confident with the electrical connection on that,
and
it's
connection.
Going to work. Yes. So then, well, let's leave that off. And then we can think about, you know, all right, how robust is this? You know, if I can I manipulate the latch? You know, is this guy, you know, on here solidly? And the answer is yes. You know, the strength comes from the anchors. The anchors are on there pretty good. You know, so you can, you know, you're not going to, like, bother it. All right. So next, test. So we're gonna test before deciding that is done. So I'll plug back in the SIM one, and then we'll see if we can dig up a air LCD and screen.
Well, actually, I think I have it. It's just an LCD, though. It doesn't have glass on it. Is that okay?
Does it have a home button?
No.
All right, we got. we'll dig one up.
The ones I have are disassembled. All
right, so that is back there. So let's dig up an air original LCD and a home button, hopefully. Stuff around here is probably garbage. All right. Probably garbage. All right, so key for air is keeping the battery isolated when we do these screens. So let's do first. This home button. The actual digitizer is forgiving, it doesn't really matter. We'll flip that up, and this, you know, should feel pretty native.
So can I ask a random question about digitizer screens while you have that there?
Sure.
So if you get a digitizer screen that's not necessarily the highest quality,
mm-hmm.
there's this, the word is out there that you should take Captain tape and line the edges with it,
mm-hmm.
and that prevents ghost touches and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
True? Not true?
Yeah, that's true. That's true. I mean, that's only on, like, the Air and the Mini. Ghosting in, like, an iPad 2 or a 3 would be from bending these dudes. That's the most common cause of ghosting.
And the
these flexes are going to be crappier on the lower quality digitizers, so more susceptible, because these are just thin little wires.
Okay.
So if they bend, and that's the common kind of beginner mistake, it seems like they should bend, but if you look in the original, they don't. They kind of fold. So pay really close attention to how it is, you know, natively when you take it apart.
Okay.
So that and then just kind of mimic that. And just kind of keep in mind that sometimes it seems like it should fold, but it should never fold. It should never make a crease. All right, so I'm putting back in the battery screw.
Oh, I see.
All right, test. So we're gonna prompt to boot through here and see what happens. All right, so it's seems like it's doesn't we didn't kill the backlight. Yay! And see if home button is working on this one or no. Smell of burning hair. Looks okay to me. Even if the cap is missing, I doubt it would be needed. Chip quick. 291 flux. Alright, so far two components seem to be missing to the left of the connector and another at the bottom of the connector. Alrighty. They don't use tape over the joints on the iPad mini. The little captain sorts it. Yeah, it's mostly just kind of like making it look like it did in the original.
Uh-huh.
So, in the iPad mini native screen, there's some black tape that is missing a lot of times in the crappy screens. Who's that kid jumping around in the background? That's Sam. Alright, iPhone 5 ghost touching because the aftermarket screens didn't have tape on it, where the Apple originals did. Alright, let's... Okay, so this says iPad is disabled, which, you know, is what happens when you have a screen that enters the passcode wrong too many times.
Oh,
so
okay.
It's, you know, it's on a countdown. Do you know the passcode?
No.
Okay. Well, it doesn't really matter, you know. So this is the test of the home button. So we can say this should wake it up, right? So home button works, right?
Yep.
All right. And we should be able to make it like turn off by home, and well, let's do that again. So power off, home button, click. So home button works. Now, if
okay.
we, you know, if it was my customer, I would say, you know, hey, I want to, you give me your passcode so that I can see if there's anything else wrong with it while
right.
it's here.
So
and especially like because I'd like to make sure Siri isn't hypersensitive. You know, like pressing this would, you know, should make Siri come up. And
oh,
I don't, you know, like some of the defects that you can get with, you know, home button is if it's hypersensitive, then that would be really annoying because it'll make Siri be like, I didn't hear you constantly and that stuff. But home button works.
Yay.
And we should be able to get it to, you know, click off with a power and home button hard reset. And come back to the Apple logo, which we can only do if the home button itself is working. So if it boots back to Apple logo, in theory, any day. There we go. So we were able to do a hard
Yay.
Reset. So home button is working.
Yay.
And
now, does that tell us those other components aren't necessary, or we don't?
Not really. I mean, we're gonna have to look them up. So that's a little bit of a side project. So
yeah.
you know, you have to kind of look up. This one was missing C6122,
yeah.
and then we can, you know, look up what those do and predict
okay.
the function of that, and also see whether or not they are no stuff, meaning we're never present. You know, this other little cap is not there. So we want to just kind of check in on all of those and see if we need to put which ones we need to put back. Alrighty. So for now, this mess is cleaned
Yay.
Up.
Yay! Thank you.
Alrighty. We'll see you next time.